In the last video, we learned about de Broglie's hypothesis. We saw how the wave property of particles, or as de Broglie called it, phase wave, is a product of the Lorentz transformation of a periodic phenomenon associated with the particle. From the frame of reference moving with the particle, this phenomenon appears to be a purely temporal one, with some frequency f. This is because, as demonstrated, these dots always stay in phase. However, in some another frame of reference, the particle is moving with a speed, v. The observer will experience this periodic phenomenon as having in spatial extension also, and not only time oscillations. This is due to the Lorentz transformation. The different parts of the phenomenon will no longer be in phase with each other. Some of them will be ahead of others, so we say that there exists a phase decoherence, or dephasing. Hence, a phase wave with a wavelength of h over p occurs in this frame. We now want to study more this wavy phenomenon. We know that one of the most important properties of waves is that they interfere with each other constructively and destructively. The resulting interference pattern, its width and size, depend very much on how the waves got deflected and diffracted, especially when they pass through narrow slits or cross sharp curves. Take, for example, the double slit experiment. The question is, if the de Broglie's wavelength depends on the state of motion of the particle and the observer, how can the interference pattern appear the same for all observers alike? To address this question, we will approach the experiment using relativity. On the left, we have the reference frame of the two-slit device with the screen, while on the right, we have the reference frame of the observer. In the observer's frame, the two slits move with a speed, v, to the left, towards the particles, such as electrons. Consequently, the path taken by the particles after crossing the two slits is shortened, resulting in a lower electron speed in this frame. In the electron's frame of reference, let's now take one electron for convenience, its velocity has a vertical component also, after it's subjected to diffraction, and not only a horizontal one. If it doesn't have a vertical velocity component, it will reach the center of the screen without deflection. In the frame of reference of the slits now, the slits are not moving, and the speed of the electron is... Our task is to show that the interference pattern is the same in all frames of reference. According to Galileo's relativity first, time in all inertial frames of reference passes at the same rate. T is the same for all frames of reference. Since the distance between the two slits is much smaller than the distance d to the screen, we consider the angle phi to be a right angle. Point A is a point of maximum intensity located at a distance b from the center of the screen. For constructive interference to occur at A, the path from the bottom slit is longer than the one from the top slit by some integer multiples of the wavelength. With a simple calculation, we can compare the difference between delta L and the difference in wavelength of the electron between the frames of reference. We find that the ratios are equal, and hence, in the non-relativistic case, the interference pattern remains the same for the frames of reference. Now we will show that the interference pattern remains the same even for high-speed particles. In the slit's frame of reference, the particle is traveling at a high speed, so its transit time from the slits to the screen is very short. The wavelength of such a particle is already small, but the relativistic mass of the particle will increase by a factor of gamma, and because of that, the wavelength will shorten even more by a factor of gamma as well. This reduces the width of the entire interference pattern by an amount proportional to gamma. In the electron's frame, the two slits are moving towards it at a high speed, so the distance from the two slits to the screen will become contracted by gamma, and the transit time after passing the slits will also be shortened by the same amount. But for the electron to reach a point A on the screen, it must have a vertical velocity component of at least the gamma factor as well. This means that in this frame also, the wavelength associated with the vertical velocity component will also be shortened by gamma. Hence, the interference pattern will be reduced by the same amount in both frames. We now move on to discuss the usefulness of the de Broglie wave in practice. Consider the electron inside the hydrogen atom. As we'll see later, the average radius of the electron's orbit in this atom is 0.53 angstroms, or 0.53 times 10 to the power of minus 10. If we now employ Newton's second law and replace the force with the Coulomb electric force and A with the centripetal acceleration, the rotation speed, v squared, over the radius, then after solving for v and substituting the numbers, we find that the speed of the electron is about 2.2 million meters per second. This is the average speed at which the electron orbits around the proton in the hydrogen atom. From this v, we now calculate de Broglie's wavelength to find that it is of the order of angstroms. The value is also the size order of the atom, 1 angstrom. This observation reveals a significant wave property exhibited by the electron within an atom, illustrating the wave-particle duality inherent in the hydrogen atom's electron and highlighting the atom's quantum properties. Consequently, the hydrogen atom qualifies as a quantum system, necessitating the application of quantum mechanics for its study, evident when comparing the electron's wavelength to the atom's size. This issue extends further, as we will see in subsequent videos, revealing the electron's uniform probability distribution of existing across the entire circumference of the atom, rather than localized at a singular point. The de Broglie wavelength determines when we should use quantum mechanics instead of classical physics. The spatial dimensions or size of the obstacle interacting with the particle must be of the order of de Broglie's wavelength in order for the quantum properties of the particle to be prominent. In geometric optics, for instance, lenses and mirrors are several orders of magnitude larger than the wavelength of the photon. Therefore, its quantum properties can easily be neglected. Let's take another example. What energy must a neutron have to exhibit a strong wave diffraction effect when encountering the surface of a crystal whose atoms are 2.5 to 6 angstroms apart? This one is easy. Solve de Broglie's equation for P and substitute it in the kinetic energy formula. In laboratories that study atomic nuclei, accelerators are designed to operate with energies of up to 6 billion electron volts. The reason for this is that the de Broglie wavelength of an electron with such energies is several times smaller than the dimensions of the atomic nucleus, which makes the wavy properties of such electrons less effective compared to the size of the studied nucleus, thus obtaining a less blurry picture of it and understanding its components in better detail. Stay tuned, and thanks for watching.